Oh, we glorify, we magnify, we exalt your name, Lord. Hallelujah. We thank you, Father. We praise your name, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Father God, we want to thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. The Spirit of God, we want to thank you. Hallelujah. Oh, we bless your name, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Oh, be enthroned, Lord. Be enthroned, Master. Hallelujah, Lord. Be enthroned, Lord. Hallelujah. Father, we want to once again, Lord, want to thank you. We want to exalt your name, Lord. Hallelujah. We thank you, Father. We bring this time, Master. Hallelujah, Lord. Take your place, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Take your place, Master. Hallelujah, Lord. Be exalted, Lord. Hallelujah. In everything, O Master. Hallelujah. That you are, hallelujah, the center of everything, O Master. Hallelujah, Lord. We pray. Hallelujah, Lord. We thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. My brother and my sister, continue to worship Jesus. Hallelujah. Lift your voice. Hallelujah. Lift your hands. Hallelujah. Oh, we praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Lord. We thank you, Father. Rabba, Deba, Rudala, Rabala, Rudala, Rajala, Rundala, Kara, Deba, Rabba. Oh, Rudha, Rabba, Deba, Rabba. We praise you, Lord. Hallelujah. Haraja, Rudha, Rabba, Deba, Ribala, Rabba. Rundala, Kara, Deba, Rabba. Rudha, Rabba, Deba, Ribala, Rabba. Kara, Rabba, Rudha, Rabba, Deba, Riba, Raja. Kara, Rabba, Kara, Rabba, Deba, Rudha, Ribala, Rabba. We praise your name, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. We thank you, Father, for this time, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. We glorify, we magnify your name, Lord. Hallelujah. We come, hallelujah, in the name of Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. We bless your name, Lord. We thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Tonight, as we come once again in your presence, Lord, we do not come with our strength, Lord. Hallelujah. We do not come with our righteousness, Lord. We do not come because what we have done, but because what you have done, Lord, we stand here, Lord. Hallelujah. We stand here because what you have done on the cross, Lord. Hallelujah. We glorify, we magnify your name, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. We praise you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to your name, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Oh, we praise you. Hallelujah.
So far away. I will pray. Even in my darkest hour, the sorrow and the pain, I will say, God, I'm afraid. Lift my hands to honor you, because your word is true. Lord, it's hard for me to see all the thoughts and plans you have for me. But I will put my trust in you, knowing that you died to set me free. But I don't know what to say,
but I don't know where to start.
But I seek in the grave, with all that's in my heart, I will say, I will pray, even in my darkest hour, to the sorrow and the pain, I will stay. I will pray. Lift my hands to honor you, because your word is true. I will stay. I will pray. Even in my darkest hour, to the sorrow and the pain. Lift my hands to honor you, because your word is true. I'll sing, I will pray, even in my darkest hour, to the sorrow and the pain. I'll sing, I'll pray. Lift my hands to honor you, because your word is true. Lord, it seems so far away, a million miles or more is today. Though I haven't lost my faith, I must confess right now that it's hard for me to pray. But I don't know what to say, don't know where to start. As you give the grave, with all that's in my heart,
I will say, I will pray,
even in my darkest hour, to the sorrow and the pain, I will say, I will pray, lift my hands to honor you, because your word is true. Even in my darkest hour, to the sorrow and the pain, I will say, I will pray, lift my hands to honor you, with all the word is true. I will say, I will pray, even in my darkest hour, to the sorrow and the pain, I will say, to honor you, because your word is true. I will say, I will pray, even in my darkest hour, to the sorrow and the pain. I will say, I will pray, lift my hands to honor you, because your word is true. I will say, I will pray, even in my darkest hour, to the sorrow and the pain. I will say, I will pray, lift my hands to honor you, because your word is true. I will say, I will pray, even in my darkest hour, to the sorrow and the pain, I will say, I will pray, lift my hands to honor you, because your word is true. I will say,
hallelujah, Lord. We thank you, Father. Your every word is true Lord, hallelujah. And every blessing, Lord, Father, but joy comes, Lord, hallelujah. We thank you, Father. We praise you, Jesus, hallelujah. We thank you, Lord. We thank you, Father, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to your name, Lord, hallelujah. Oh, we praise you, Master, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus, hallelujah.
For the cross, Lord. Thank you for the niggas and the ring of my sin and shame. In love you came and gave amazing grace. Thank you for the love, Lord.
Worthy is the Lamb, hallelujah, that was slain for you hallelujah. The valley of heaven was crucified for you and me, hallelujah, Lord. We thank you, Father. You are more than worthy, Lord, hallelujah, Lord. We thank you, Father. We bless your name, hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want you to turn to Jeremiah 32, hallelujah. I'm sorry, 31, 32. Hallelujah. We bless your name, Lord. Hallelujah. This is the covenant I will make with the people of Israel after that time, declares the Lord. I will put my law in their minds and write it on their hearts. I will be their God and they will be my people. No longer will they teach their neighbor or say to one another, know the Lord, because they will all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, declares the Lord. For I will forgive their wickedness and will remember their sins no more. Hallelujah. My brother and my sister, hallelujah. God spoke to Jeremiah, hallelujah, that the law, hallelujah, hallelujah, will bring return on our hearts and minds. Hallelujah. And the greatest, hallelujah, of the commandments is, hallelujah, to love the God with all our heart and with all our mind, hallelujah, and to love one another, hallelujah. These are the two commandments, hallelujah, hallelujah, which was written, hallelujah, not on the tablets because the law was perfect, hallelujah, but the people were imperfect, hallelujah. Even today, we are imperfect, but because of the righteousness of Jesus, hallelujah, where God, hallelujah, through his blood, we were reconciled, hallelujah. As we continue to look to the cross, our righteousness comes from the cross, from the blood of Jesus, hallelujah. And the law is written in our hearts, hallelujah, hallelujah. And the word of the Lord says that he's not going to remember any of our sins anymore, hallelujah. This is the promise of God, hallelujah, hallelujah. I remember the man of God, hallelujah. And it's so important that when we come in the house of God, we don't have to tell each other every time whom we serve. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The man of God spoke, hallelujah, a couple of weeks back about the word that was ministered. Knowing our God, who our God is, hallelujah, that each one should be in the reverential awe when we come as a church whom we serve. We serve Jesus, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Hallelujah. We don't have to keep telling ourselves, hallelujah, hallelujah. The word of the Lord says, hallelujah. You don't have to say, hallelujah. No longer will they teach their neighbor or say to one another, know the Lord, because they will all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, declares the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We bless your name, Lord. Hallelujah. We thank you, Father, as we sing this song, hallelujah. Because the dead does not worship, hallelujah, but only the people who are alive worship. Hallelujah. And Jesus is enthroned on our praises. As we sing the song, my brother and my sister, I encourage you, whatever the situation, hallelujah, 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 is to glorify Jesus, hallelujah. We have been called to magnify his name and exalt his name, hallelujah. We thank you, Jesus, hallelujah. We praise you, Jesus, hallelujah. We thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. We praise you. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah.
I know you rescued my soul. His blood has covered my sin. I believe.
Do you believe?
My shame is taken away. My pain is healing this day. I believe. I'll raise a banner. My Lord has conquered the grave. My Redeemer lives. My soul. this mountain top to see your kingdom come. My Redeemer lives. 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 My shame was taken away. Oh, my pain is healed in His name. I believe. I believe. I'll raise the banner. Oh, my Lord has conquered the grave. My Redeemer lives. My Redeemer lives. My Redeemer.
Our Redeemer. Ever heard what the Lord can do, who have been called, who love Jesus, and who have been called as per the plan and purpose. Hallelujah. That Jesus has gathered here. Hallelujah. Jesus is building a church, my brother and my sister, for the second coming, an unblemished church. And you and I are the people. We have been bought out of, hallelujah, Lord, from every law, every religious bondage. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, that you and I, hallelujah, hallelujah. And what the Lord is asking us, hallelujah, is a heart which is submitted, hallelujah. A heart which is surrendered, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. While we have all the promises, hallelujah, hallelujah. Matthew, hallelujah, the book of Matthew says, hallelujah. It is so important that the word of the Lord says, whatever, even little that he has given, we need to, hallelujah. It could be a little praise. It can be a little amens and a little lifting of hands. Hallelujah. And we do that, the word of the Lord says he's going to multiply that. Unless we don't come and worship, hallelujah. We don't open our mouth, hallelujah. The word of the Lord says when we have all the promises, hallelujah. But also there's something very important. Otherwise, the word of the Lord says that, hallelujah, that whatever little we have, that will be taken away. Hallelujah. It is so important that whatever little we have, hallelujah, because, hallelujah, how we respond in a time of crisis will tell us where we are heading. Hallelujah. When, hallelujah, we are not able to worship the Lord, hallelujah, we need to tell, hallelujah, Lord God, hallelujah, my body and my mind is tired, but I chose to give you the praise, Lord. While I take the step of faith, the Spirit will enable us. It will put the utterances, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. It is so important, hallelujah, how we respond in a time of crisis, hallelujah. If you remember the word that was ministered, hallelujah, about Daniel, hallelujah. He never compromised, hallelujah, on the word, hallelujah, hallelujah. Even a place which was hostile, but yet he stood on the promises of God. He could have just bowed down to the idols, but he knew that his promise, hallelujah, the greater promise what awaited him, hallelujah. Tonight when we come, hallelujah, it is so important, hallelujah, to exalt his name and to worship, hallelujah. In fact, my brother and my sister, I told the Lord, do not take my worship away, Lord, hallelujah. Because if I bring thee worship, you will give me the word, hallelujah. Because the word is what will separate us. Hallelujah, hallelujah. It is important that we need to come and exalt the name together, my brother and my sister, because each one who's come here, hallelujah, this is the plan of God. It is not something, hallelujah, the man has spoken about this. It's not a coincidence. It's not possible. Jesus has built this church, and every soul that is, he's adding, and he has already added, it's a church will only exalt the name of Jesus. Nothing. Hallelujah. It is all about Jesus. Hallelujah. The vision was given. Hallelujah. The people. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It's all about Jesus. It's all about we coming together and glorifying the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. We praise you, Lord. And everything, my master, the word of the Lord says, everything, every blessing of Abraham, Jacob, and Isaac is ours. If we are worshipers, if we worship, God is going to send forth this promise. This is the perfect plan of Jesus. Hallelujah. We praise you. Hallelujah. We praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. We magnify your name, Lord, in this place. We exalt you, Lord. Hallelujah.
Love that verse for the prophets. The one. to come.
Heaven came for us, reconciling us.
Yeah.
In Jesus' name, Jesus' name.
By His stripes we are healed. By His death we can live.
In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name.
All our passion will cease,
and we capture will be. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name.
Savior for us.
Sickness, hallelujah. We praise you, Master. That's our Jesus, hallelujah. Hallelujah. The only Son who came on this earth, hallelujah. Who lived amongst people, hallelujah. Hallelujah. And every time, hallelujah. Hallelujah. He thought about you and me, hallelujah. He's written our very names on His palms. Hallelujah. Our very names are written. Hallelujah. And He knows, my brother and my sister, every tear that has fallen, my brother and my sister. I do not know if people wouldn't have seen it. Hallelujah. But the Lord knows every tear. Hallelujah. He's collected every tear, every anxiety, every fear. Hallelujah. Because there's nothing that is hidden from Jesus. Hallelujah. Tonight as we come, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let's surrender our lives the way we are. Jesus says, come the way you are, all who labor, and I will give you rest. Hallelujah. My brother and my sister, tonight as we come, hallelujah. It's all about Jesus. Hallelujah. It's all about Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, because there's no other name, and there is no other way except through the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We praise you, Master. We thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. We glorify, we magnify. Hallelujah. There's nothing, Lord. Hallelujah. 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 Who are you mindful, Lord? Hallelujah. That you shed your blood, O Master. Hallelujah, that you have given us this new lease of life, oh Father God. We thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. We praise you, Father. We praise you, Lord. We praise you, Master, for each one that you have given, Lord, in our lives, Father God. We want to bless your name. We want to honor you, Lord. Hallelujah. Father God, we want to bless your name. We want to glorify. We want to magnify your name, Lord. Hallelujah. Bless your name.
See the
Your name, Lord. We honor
we give
you, Lord.
You glory,
hallelujah,
to
Lord.
Your
we
name.
Praise you, Father. We magnify your name, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, we praise you, Lord. Hallelujah.
You, Lord.
We thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
We honor you, Lord.
Hallelujah. We praise you. We thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
I'm taking my sickness. I'm taking.
Whenever, hallelujah, Jesus had to take, hallelujah, 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 he had to change his course. Whenever, hallelujah, there was someone who was shouting his name, hallelujah. Whenever there was someone, hallelujah, Jesus had to change his course and come for that one person, hallelujah. Tonight, as we sing the song once again, my brother and my sister, this song we would have sang so many times, you know, sometimes it becomes just another song, hallelujah. We might be just singing. But if you actually mean the song, hallelujah, hallelujah, that I'm trading my sorrows, hallelujah, Jesus is in our midst. The word of the Lord says that he delights in blessing, hallelujah.
That's right. That's
and every day, hallelujah, he delights, hallelujah, in blessing. He's the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow, hallelujah. He can still part the Red Sea, hallelujah. I remember the man of God used one term. I don't know how many people remember that. There's going to be some airdrops, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Sometimes we think how this thing is going to work out. I don't think it's possible. Or we would have said, okay, it's going to work in this fashion. We would have already made up our minds. But as the word, hallelujah, 1 Corinthians talks about that no eye has seen, hallelujah. I just want to share this small hallelujah happening which happened in my office, hallelujah. Where I was there, my boss, whatever I was doing, but never encouraged. And it was becoming so tough, so difficult, hallelujah. A lot of people would have encountered, hallelujah. It came to a point I wanted to quit and go. I wanted to put down my papers, hallelujah. Hallelujah. And I always plan things. And I said, either I'm going to quit the job or I'm going to find another job. These were all the calculations in my mind. Hallelujah. But what the Lord did was, hallelujah, something extraordinary. He split the unit into two. He gave one part to my boss, one part he gave it to me. Hallelujah. So I don't report to my boss. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. What I'm trying to tell is, he can still part the Red Sea in our lives. Sometimes we might think that, is it going to really work? Hallelujah. If there's something, some financial crisis, is it really going to come? Hallelujah. Is this marriage going to happen? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. But my brother and my sister, Jesus is real. Hallelujah. He's real. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He's been changing life for 2015 years. He's continuing to change life. Hallelujah. He just needs a touch. Hallelujah. The woman with the issue of blood, when she touched, hallelujah. 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 I do not know what the condition is, what the situations are. My brother and my sister, the best thing to do is to lay it at the feet of Jesus. Lay it at the feet of Jesus. Do not evaluate, do not calculate, because it is not possible for us to, hallelujah, think the way the Lord thinks. His ways are higher than our ways. When we lay it at his feet, my brother and my sister, he will do something extraordinary for us. Because we, hallelujah, are the elect. We are the elect. God has brought us into his presence that he could bless us. But it is so important. We have to rid of all these things and just glorify his name. And suddenly you'll see the kind of breakthroughs that will happen. Hallelujah. And suddenly when you look back and see, you'll think, oh, I was thinking about my marriage and here I'm with a kid. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The God can do extraordinary things in our lives, hallelujah. But if we chose to worship, hallelujah. So every time we sing a song, there need to be a new enthusiasm, a new hope, a new belief, a new, hallelujah, anticipation that God is going to do something new. Otherwise, it will just be another song which we would have sang in the religious. In fact, there are so many songs I would have sang without knowing what I was singing. Because it becomes, after some time, something that we have to do it. Hallelujah. But today, as we sing every song, my brother, my sister, it's got a power when we exalt the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. As we sing the song, I want you to, together we are going to trade every sorrow. Hallelujah. We are going to trade. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And this joy that is going to come in our lives. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yes, brother. We praise you.
I'm trading my
the sorrow that lasts for the night.
Thank you.
mein Gaul, tere pyar ke geet mein gaul. I can sing of your love forever. I can sing of your love forever.
Oh.
Jesus Christ, the only name that saves. Oh God, fall upon the name Jesus Christ, the only name that saves.
Oh, there is no one like our God. There's no one like our God. There's nothing that can stand against the death. No stronghold you can break. No life that you can save. Our God, you never will fail. For there is no one like our God. No one like our God. Who can stand against you? There's no stronghold you can break. No life that you can save. Our God, you never
started walking, and then his eyes went towards the wind and towards the storms that were coming by his way, and he made this prayer to the Lord, and it's become my favorite prayer in the past few months. It's just a 3-word prayer. He made a prayer to this Lord saying, Lord, save me.
Amen.
And the Lord did save him.
Hallelujah.
The Lord stretched out his hand to him and put him back to the shore.
Amen.
I don't know what sort of trial you are sinking in. I don't know what sort of temptations you have to deal with. I don't know what sort of pain you have to deal with. I don't know what is making your heart sink. I don't know what is making your faith sink. I don't know what is making, you know, your walk with the Lord to sink, to just drown. But if you can just make that 3-word prayer to the Lord, just in faith, if you can just say, Lord, save me.
Lord,
because
save me.
There is no one else who can save me, Lord. There is no one else who can deliver me, Lord. There is no one else who can bring me out, Lord. You're the only one, Lord, who can deliver my soul from tears, from death, my feet from falling. Thank you, Jesus. We worship you, Lord. Whatever is distracting you, whatever is troubling you, whatever is your battle, if you can just make that simple prayer to the Lord, if you can just call upon the name of the Lord, He's just a cry away. He's just a cry away. Don't lose your cry for the Lord. If you can just say, Abba Father, if you can just say, Lord, save me. If you can just cry out like that blind Bartimaeus who cried out, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me.
Hallelujah. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
My Bible says that there was a widow who cried out to a judge, an unjust judge. And the judge answered her. My Bible says, how much more my God will answer those who cry out to Him day and night. If an unjust judge, a judge who doesn't care for man, who doesn't care about anything, can answer a widow, how much more, my God, will answer your cry? How much more He will wipe away your tears? How much more He will comfort you? How much more He will deliver you? How much more will He give you breakthrough? How much more will He give you justice? How much more will He give you victory over the enemy? It's just a cry away. Oh, we call upon your name, Jesus. One who can save us, O Lord. You are our helper, O Lord. You are our resurrection and our life, O Lord. You are our comforter, O Lord. You are our healer, Lord. You are our deliverer, O Lord. There is nothing impossible with you, God. There is nothing impossible with you, God. What is impossible with man is possible with you, God. Children, Lord, save our church, O Lord. Us, O Lord.
Oh, yes, Lord.
Oh, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you that you have brought your children thus far, O Lord. Thank you that you have brought them thus far, O Lord. Thank you for your mercies upon them, your goodness upon them. Thank you, O Lord, that you are not through with them, Lord. That you care for them, O Lord. That you are able, O Lord. That you are a mighty God, O Lord, who can save them, O Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Father, we surrender the word into thy hands, the service into thy hands. We welcome you, Holy Spirit, here. Your word says, let the church hear what the Spirit has to speak, O Lord. Today, let every ear be open, Lord. Let every eyes be open, Lord. Let every heart, every mind be open, Lord. Father, let every rebellion leave, Lord. Let every negative voices leave, Lord. Let every lie of the enemy in their minds leave, O Lord. Every battle in their minds, Lord. We enforce the victory of your cross, of your blood over it, O Lord. We apply your precious blood, Lord, from the crown of the head to the soles of your feet, of your children, Lord. We enforce your victory, Lord. We enforce your freedom, Lord. We enforce your peace, Lord. We enforce wholeness, O Lord. Father, when you open a door, no man can shut it, O Lord. We thank you for this door that you have opened, O Lord. We thank you for making a way through the cross, O Lord. Oh, we worship you, Jesus. We worship you. Once again this evening, Lord, we just put our hopes back in you, O Lord. We put our hope back on you, O Lord. Your word says, O Lord, that this I call to mind and therefore I have hope. That the steadfast love of the Lord never ceases.
Amen.
His mercies are new every morning.
Hallelujah.
And His compassions never fail.
Praise
and great is thy faithfulness,
Hallelujah.
O Lord. We thank you that we have a faithful God in our midst,
Amen.
O Lord. We surrender everything at your feet, Lord. At your nail-pierced feet, O Lord. Do a work within us, O Lord, today. Do a work inside of us, O Lord. Let there be a change, O Lord, in our lives, O Lord, through this word, O Lord. Let this not be a routine service, Lord. Let this not be just mere hearing, Lord. Let this not be just to receive some knowledge, Lord. Father God, we want your truth, your word to set us free today, Lord. We are hungry for you, Lord. We are thirsty for you, Lord. We are longing for you, Lord. Do a work in our lives, Lord. Thank you, Jesus, Lord. To you be all the glory, Lord. All the honor, Lord. Amen. All the praise, O Lord. In Jesus' mighty and precious name we make our prayer, Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Let's be seated. Thank you, Jesus. Let's open our Bibles to the book of Psalm, chapter 23, verse 4. Jesus. Someone can read it for me.
Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me.
Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You know, the word is saying, David is writing here, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me, O Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. What a comfort just to hear that one scripture. Amen. Hallelujah. You know, if you can put a title to this word, it's simply this. Don't stay in your valley. Amen. Don't stay in your valley. Hallelujah. Can you look at your neighbor and say, don't stay in your valley. Don't stay in your valley. Amen. Hallelujah. The psalmist is writing here, David is writing here, that though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. In other words, you will have to go through the valley. Amen. But David took a decision that if I'm going to go through this valley, let me just go through this valley. Amen. Because my God is with me. My shepherd is with me. Amen. He is able to deliver me. Amen. He is able to bring me out. Amen. Hallelujah. Are you all on mountaintop experiences here? I don't think so. Because I think it's only when we go through valleys that we all show up in the house of God. That we are desperate for the word. Amen. Hallelujah. But the Bible is saying if you have to go through the valley, just go through the valley. Amen. But remember that God is with you in the valley. Your good shepherd is with you in the valley. And he is able to bring you out of it. Amen. So we are going to look at some valleys. Amen. Mentioned in the Bible. Hallelujah. And we are going to learn and we are going to take a decision today to come out of those valleys. Amen. If any of you here are stuck in any of those valleys, take a decision today. Ask the help of the Holy Spirit today to bring you out of those valleys. Amen. God doesn't want you to be stuck in a valley. Amen. You might go through it, but he doesn't want you to remain there. He doesn't want you to put a tent or build a monument there and just stay there grieving over it. Amen. He wants to bring you out of your valleys. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Do you want to come out of your valleys? Amen. Hallelujah. So let's turn to the book of Joshua, chapter 7, verse 26.
Then they raised over him a great heap of stones, still there to this day. So the Lord turned from the fierceness of his anger. Therefore, the name of that place has been called the Valley of Achor to this day.
Amen. Hallelujah. So the first valley here that's mentioned is the Valley of Achor. Amen. And in this valley, you will find this man, the servant of God, Joshua. And if you read the previous chapters, Joshua had won about 32 battles or so. He had won every battle that came by his way. And suddenly he comes to this one battle and he fails. The whole of Israel is defeated. Amen. Why? We know, we have heard this before from Pastor, that because there was someone in their group, there was someone in their team, you know, there was someone who was, you know, fighting with them, who did something that God told them not to do. There was this man called Achan who got distracted. Amen. He went and he picked up a very attractive looking Babylonian garment and he took it and he hid it inside his tent. And because of that, it was not just that one man, but it was the whole of Israel. Joshua and all of them had to face defeat in that battle. The Valley of Achor is the valley of distraction. Amen. It's when you are going through that point where you don't want to go away from the Lord. You don't want to turn your back to him. But somewhere along in your walk with the Lord, you have got distracted. You are distracted from God's purpose. You are distracted from God's call. You are distracted from worship. You are distracted from the plan of God, from the will of God. Somewhere along the line, your focus has gone away from the Lord. Somewhere along the line, your heart has become very dim and you know, other things are looking very attractive to you. It can be a job. I'm not saying that you should, you know, reject every good job that comes by your way. But sometimes there can be a job that looks so attractive to you, but can actually distract you from the purpose and the plan that God has from your life. It can be a simple thing as an SMS or a Facebook post that can just distract you from where God wants you to walk in. Amen. That's what happened to Achan. Amen. But don't stay in that valley. All of us get distracted on and off. Amen. Somewhere on the line, we tend to lose our focus. Amen. It can be a conversation with a friend. Amen. It can be the things happening in your workplace. It can be, you know, in your college. Amen. Things, you know, people seem to be boasting of a lot of attractive things. And you feel very tempted to go into it. And you get distracted. But the Lord doesn't want us to stay there. Amen. He wants to bring you out of the valley of distraction. Amen. Hallelujah. He wants us to come out of the valley of distraction. Amen. Hallelujah. It's not that you deliberately want to go away from the Lord. You still have faith in the Lord. You still believe in the Lord. Your faith, your doctrines, everything is correct. But you are not walking in God's call or God's purpose or God's plan. You are just probably existing as a believer. Or, you know, you are just, you know, superficially walking as a Christian. Because somewhere along the line, we get distracted. Something in the world looks more attractive. Something that's outside of God's word, outside of God's plan, outside of God's will, looks more attractive, and we go after it. Amen. And we know what happened to Achan. You know, we know how he was buried there, and it was named the Valley of Trouble. Amen. But today the Lord wants to bring us out. Amen. Even if we go through that valley, he's there with us to bring us out. Amen. If you're feeling lukewarm, if you're feeling cold, if you're feeling your focus has gone away from the Lord, he's there to help you. He's there to deliver you. He's there to bring you out. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You know, there's this old English saying that we say, all that glitters is not gold. Right? All that glitters is not gold. Amen. Hallelujah. You know, you should take a decision, you know, that Lord, ask the help of the Holy Spirit. Ask for his grace. We are all just a work under progress. You know, so we need the help of the Lord. Tell the Lord, Lord, if there is any area in my life where I've been distracted, where something else is looking more attractive to me than God, than his plan, than his purpose, then I want to come out today, Lord, with your help. Amen. Hallelujah. So let's move on to another valley. Numbers 32, verse 9.
For when they went up to the valley of Eshcol and saw the land, they discouraged the heart of the children of Israel, so that they did not go into the land which the Lord had given them.
Amen. Hallelujah. So it is speaking of the valley of Eshcol. Amen. So where does this valley come? This valley comes when God had already promised the Israelites, you know, that they would enter the promised land. It was already, you know, settled once and for all. It was his word. But there were 12 spies who went out to explore that land. And you've all heard the story before that out of those 12 spies, you know, only two of them, Joshua and Caleb, came back in faith and believing that, yes, we can take this land. But there were 10 people who came back to that valley, and there were 10 people who doubted in it, who were having unbelief, who felt that, no, we just can't conquer this promise. We just can't make it through. It just cannot happen. This is impossible. So the valley of Eshcol is a valley of doubt and unbelief. Amen. Hallelujah. You know, sometimes there are always these doubts going in your head. No matter how many years you have grown in the Lord also, you still have these doubts. Does God really have a plan for me? Why am I in the city? Or why am I working in this office? Or why has God given me a job like this? Or why am I living in this particular neighborhood? Does God have a plan for me in this city? But amen, but we should take a decision today. Lord, bring me out of that valley of doubt. Amen. I don't want to be doubting your promises. I don't want to be doubting why God has put me here. I don't want to be doubting on the call of God, on his purpose, on his plan over my life. Amen. Some of us, we have seen immensely the goodness of God in our lives, and still we doubt, will God do anything good in my life? We look at all, we focus on all the ugly things in our life. We focus on all the things that we don't have, that haven't happened. And then we think, oh God, will you do anything good in my life? It's a valley of doubt. And you know what happens if you stay in the valley of doubt? That doubt slowly progresses into unbelief in God. Amen. So as soon as you're in the valley of doubt, ask the Lord, Lord, I want to come out of this. Amen. Hallelujah. You know, sometimes you will go through situations where, you know, your life and what the word says doesn't match. It doesn't make sense. Sometimes you'll go through situations where you hold on to the promise of God. You know, you're holding on, you're praying, you're doing everything, but the consequences, the reality that you're seeing is completely contrary. But that doesn't mean that God is not true. That doesn't mean that God is not faithful. Amen. You know, just take an example, like maybe you had a sickness. And when you got that sickness or something, when you got that doctor's report, you started believing, by stripes I'm healed. By stripes I'm healed. But somewhere along the line, you heard of someone else who had the same sickness, who didn't get healed, you know, who eventually probably met even with his deathbed. And then you begin to doubt God inside you. Oh, will God really heal me of this sickness? You know, can God really heal me of this problem? But let me ask you something. You know, if you look at the hospitals here in Bangalore, there are several patients who die every day in the hospitals. But does that stop you from going to a hospital when you're sick? Amen. It doesn't, right? There are several people who take medicines, you know, for various illnesses, you know, and they may not get healed, but they still keep taking those medicines. They still don't stop. Then why should we quit on our God? Amen. Why should we think that our God will fail us? Why should we be stuck in that valley of doubt? Amen. Why should we always, even us, be stuck in that unbelief? That no, I don't think I'll see the goodness of God. No, I don't think God has a plan over life. No, I don't think God can forgive all of my sins. That is the silliest doubt, I think. Because God has done all that he can do for us on the cross. He's demonstrated it in the biggest manner, I mean in an unquestioning manner, that he has forgiven our sins. Then why should we ever doubt? Why should we ever, you know, think that no, God cannot forgive my sins? Why should we ever have the thought that, oh, I've fallen too many times, I don't think I can come back to the Lord? Amen. Hallelujah. Don't remain in the valley of doubt. Amen. Don't remain in that valley of doubt. Oh, will my family be saved? Will God bless me? Will God fulfill his promises for me? Amen. I know some of us, yeah, we have probably been waiting for ages to see, you know, people in our family saved, or people in our workplace saved, or people in our neighborhood saved. But it is God's promise that just as he told the Israelites, that this city has been given to us. Amen. The place that you're working in has been given to you. Amen. The place that you're living in has been given to you. Amen. Don't be like those 10 spies who doubted. Amen. I don't think God is going to save these people anytime soon. Amen. Come out of that valley of doubt. Amen. Hallelujah. Don't doubt the goodness of God over your life. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You know, I just want us to go to a scripture, 2 Timothy 1 verse 5.
When I call to remembrance the genuine faith that is in you, which dwelt first in your grandmother Louis and your mother Eunice, and I am persuaded is in you also.
Amen. Hallelujah. So here is Paul, and he's writing to Timothy, and he is telling Timothy something very interesting. You know, he's telling Timothy that the same faith that was in your grandmother, that was in your mother, I see the same faith in you, Timothy. Amen. When you're going through a valley of doubt, what you should do is gather around people of faith. Amen. We don't know what Timothy's dad was like, or what his siblings were like, whether they believed in the Lord, whether they had faith in the Lord. Amen. Sometimes you might go through a situation where your spouse may not be having faith, or your siblings don't have faith, or your parents don't have faith, where you are maybe the only one who's standing up for the Lord, and you're feeling doubting inside, you're wondering, oh, is it all true, is it all worth it, will God really save my family? But during that time, gather with people of faith. Amen. When you're going through a doubting time, you know, get together with people of faith. Amen. Receive the word into you. Amen. Receive whatever counsel God has to give. Sometimes just a simple word of prayer can break that doubt away from your mind. Amen. And come out of that valley of doubt. Don't stay in it. Amen. Because it will eventually lead to unbelief in God. Amen. It will eventually turn your heart away from the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The third valley that I want to speak about is called the Valley of Kidron. Now, this Valley of Kidron, if you look at it historically, it's a valley that was concentrated with many tombs. There were many people buried there. And one such person, you know, who was buried there was Lazarus. Amen. So, we know what happened to Lazarus. When Jesus called out to him, the Bible says that Lazarus responded to the call of God. Lazarus responded to the word of God. And this dead man was resurrected and came to life. Amen. What am I talking about? I'm talking about the dead things in your life. Amen. It can be a dead dream in your life. It can be a talent inside of you that's dead. It can be sometime you were believing for some promise or for some prophecy, but no longer you're holding on to it. It's dead. It can be a dream inside, a wish inside of you, a prayer inside of you. But you can come out of that valley. Don't let it be dead over there. Amen. You respond to the word of God and ask God's life to flow over it. Amen. You know, the word Kidron has another meaning. It also means a dark color. Or, you know, to move around in sackcloth. Or to be very heavy inside. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You know, all of us go through those times of darkness in our lives. All of us go through times where we are heavy inside, where we are hurt inside, where we are wounded inside, where there's pain inside. But the problem is, sometimes, once that offense has happened, once that wound has happened to us, we tend to remain in it for years and years. We are just stuck in that valley of pain. We are just stuck in that valley of feeling so heavy and just being in that dark place. Somebody wounded us, somebody hurt us 5 years ago, and we are still thinking over it. Oh, that person did that to me. I don't think I can ever get back to that person. Or, you know, or some disappointment happened in your life, and you think, oh, I believed in the Lord, and he's not showed up in this A, B, C, D, these areas. So, you know, I'm just going to leave it. But let me tell you, everyone goes through wounds. Everyone goes through offenses. Everyone goes through hurts. Everyone goes through pain. But it is our decision, it is our choice to come out of that valley, to go to the Lord, to go to the Lord's feet, to receive healing for it. Or else we are going to miss on the blessing that God has for us. You know, I recently heard my pastor say something, you know, about unforgiveness. He said, if you have unforgiveness in your heart, it's like you are drinking the poison and you're waiting for the other person to die. That's really what unforgiveness is. Every time we are bitter inside, every time we are resented, carry resentment inside, every time we are hurting and always wounded, you know, and we just carry it forever and ever inside of us, we are the ones who are drinking the poison, while the other person goes free and walks around happy. Amen. What we need to do is come to the Lord. Amen. Just like we sang today, you know, trade your sorrows. Trade your pain at the cross. Receive God's healing. And we just have to take that choice. Lord, whatever happens, I don't want to miss on your blessing. I am going to forgive this person. I am going to love this person. I am going to pray for this person and I am going to move on. Amen. Hallelujah. You will go. You will face pain in your life. You will face wounds in your life. Amen. Hallelujah. You know, the Bible says that, you know, in Psalm 84, that blessed are those who go through the valley of Baca. The valley of Baca means the valley of weeping, the valley of tears. We'll all go through those times, you know, where we have tears, where we will have weeping, where we will have pain, where we will have hurt, where we'll have disappointments. But do not stay in that valley. Come out of your valley. Amen. Hallelujah. You know, I remember long back pastor sharing this word to us that from Jeremiah 12, that if you have run with footmen and you have grown weary, then how can you run with horses? Amen. You can go back home and read that scripture. If you have run with footmen, you are facing mere problems through men. You know, and you've grown weary, you've grown tired, you just want to give up, you just want to quit. Then how can you run with horses? Amen. God is training you to run with horses. Amen. You know, it's like a metamorphosis that happens in your life. You know, it's not like the butterfly just springs up immediately. There is a time that the butterfly is in that pupa stage. It's like a cocoon. It has to go through that pressure. It has to go through darkness. It's not seeing anything around it. It doesn't know anything that's beautiful. It's not experiencing anything good. But it's a pressure inside. It's a weeping. It's a wounding. It's an offense inside. But then that is a time where that butterfly's, you know, muscles get built up. And that is a time when it comes out, you know, it gets wings to fly. Amen. So don't grow weary with footmen problems. Amen. We all get hurt, but trade it at the cross. Amen. Claim the Lord's word over your life. Lord, by your stripes, I was already healed, O Lord. Amen. I'm going to give this problem to you, O Lord. If I'm going to cry, I'm going to cry at your feet, O Lord. And I'm going to forgive this person, O Lord. I'm going to let go of this offense, O Lord. And I'm going to move forward, O Lord. I don't want to grow weary, O Lord, through footmen problems, O Lord. I want to run with horses. Amen. Come out of your valley of Kidron. Come out of that valley of heaviness, of darkness. Amen. Hallelujah. The next valley that we all know of is in Ezekiel 37. You know, it's something that we hear time and again. It's the valley of dry bones. Now, who are the people that live in dry places? Can we just read from Psalm 68, verse 6?
O God, when you went out before your people, when you marched through the wilderness, the earth shook. The heavens also dropped rain at the presence of God. Sinai itself was smooth at the presence of God, the God of Israel. You, O God, sent a plentiful rain, whereby you confirmed your inheritance when it was weary.
Psalm 68, verse 6.
God sets the solitary in families. He brings out those who are bound into prosperity. But the rebellious dwell in a dry land.
Amen. Hallelujah. Who are the people who live in dry places? The rebellious. Amen. That's the valley of dry bones. A time when you're rebelling against God. Amen. When you're rebelling against the authorities God has put over you. Amen. You know, we should never let church become just a routine in our lives. Never let church become just a routine in your lives. Never let church be something that you come to just for a feel-good sake. Oh, I'm feeling very down and depressed at home. Oh, I didn't have a very great day at work today. So let me just go to church and feel good and come back. Yes, God comforts you. God gives you peace. God gives you healing. But that should not be the reason why we come to church. Church should not be something that's very monotonous. That's like, oh, I've been in the city for years. Every Friday and Sunday I come. So let me just show up again. Amen. That's the time that you become dry inside. Amen. Don't be a dry bone. Amen. Can you tell each other, don't be a dry bone? Don't be a dry bone. Amen. Hallelujah. You know, we should never ever lose our hunger and our thirst for the Lord. Amen. This year, that should be the cry of our heart, that Lord, I would never lose that hunger for you, Lord. That I would never lose that thirst for you, O Lord. For your courts, for your presence, for your word. We heard last Sunday about having a strong desire for the presence of God. Amen. Hallelujah. Never allow yourself to stay in that valley of dryness. Sometimes we go through seasons of dryness. I think all of us go through that in our lives. But somewhere we are going through a dry patch. But don't be stuck over there. Amen. Come out of it. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The other valley that we are going to look into it's not clearly mentioned in the word, but if you search on it, you will find it's called the Valley of Hinnon, H-I-N-N-O-N. If you study in the word of God, in the book of Acts chapter 1, you will find that this man Judas, who betrayed the Lord, Judas went and hung himself in a field that was in the Valley of Hinnon. Why did he hang himself there? Purely out of guilt and condemnation. Amen. So that's the Valley of Hinnon. The Valley of Hinnon is a valley of guilt and condemnation. Don't be stuck in guilt and condemnation and regret. Amen. You know, sometimes we go through those times where, you know, we are just feeling so ashamed and so guilty because of some defeat in the past, some failure in the past, and we are holding on to it and we are just stuck to it. Or some mistake that we did in the past. There is nobody sitting out here who's not done a mistake. There's absolutely nobody here. But God doesn't want us to sit in guilt. He doesn't want us to sit in regret. He doesn't want to sit us bound to the past. Amen. We have to come out of that valley of guilt, that valley of condemnation, that valley of regret. You know, sometimes condemnation is not from the Lord. Sometimes you think that, oh, it is from the Lord that I should be feeling like this. I should be feeling guilty. I should be feeling very ashamed and condemned inside. But it is not from the Holy Spirit. It's very clear from the word of God, Romans 8, 1, verse 1, that there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Amen. You know, a lot of us, we read John 3:16, but we miss out on verse 17. All of us know John 3:16, right? Can some one of you read verse 17?
For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved.
Amen. Don't miss out on John 3:17. God so loved the world that he sent his Son. But why did he send his Son? He sent his Son to save you, not to condemn you. So that thought of condemnation is never from the Lord. The thought of guilt, the thought of regret about the past, about some mistake that you did, or about something that you didn't know, or about some failure, it's not from the Lord. Amen. Don't stay in the valley of condemnation. Amen. It will really block you from going forward in the Lord. Amen. Don't get stuck over there thinking, oh, I was not faithful at this time. Oh, I didn't do this when pastor called me. Oh, I didn't do that to the sister. Oh, I had hatred here, this, there. All you need to do is very simple in 1 John 1 verse 9. That if you confess your sins before the Lord, he is just, he is righteous, he is merciful to forgive you and to cleanse you. Amen. You know, there is a word that says in Micah chapter 7. It says that, you know, God has cast all our sin into the depths of the sea. Amen. And I like what one man of God said. He's put a board over there saying, no fishing. Amen. No fishing. No digging up of our past failures, of our regrets, of our mistakes. Amen. Hallelujah. It will keep you from going forward. Whether it's in your family, whether it's in the church, whether it's at your work, whatever it is, no digging up. Amen. No more fishing of the past. It is forgiven. It is under the depths of seas. The Bible says in the book of Hebrews that even God doesn't remember your sin. Then why on earth would you want to remember it? Amen. It doesn't do us any good. Just ask God for forgiveness and the grace to come out of that valley. Amen. Hallelujah. The next valley that I want us to read about is the book of Joel chapter 3. Can we read verse 12 and verse 14?
Let the nations be wakened and come up to the valley of Jehoshaphat, for there I will sit to judge all the surrounding nations. Multitudes in the valley of decision.
Amen. Hallelujah. The next valley is the valley of Jehoshaphat. The valley of Jehoshaphat is the valley of decision. Amen. It's a valley of decision. You know, there is this verse in 1 Kings where Elijah tells the people of Israel. He asks them a question. He asks them, how long will you falter between two opinions? Amen. How long will you falter between two opinions? How long will we take to decide, oh, am I going to serve this God or am I going to serve that God? Am I going to go to this church or should I be just holding on to this church? Am I going to, you know, walk in all the traditional ways or in the ways of the world, or am I going to walk in the ways of God? Amen. It's a valley of decision. Amen. You know, the Bible says that you cannot serve two masters. You will end up being restless and you will end up reaching nowhere. Amen. We need to take a decision. Amen. That, you know, that we are not going to falter between opinions. That if, you know, we took a step out for the Lord, we are going to continue living for the Lord. Amen. No turning back. Amen. Hallelujah. No turning back. Amen. You know, there can be times and seasons in your life where you're not sure of certain things. But you should not stay forever in that period of unsurety. You know, you can't imagine that you finished your 12th grade and you have to choose what to do next. You can't spend 5-6 years sitting and thinking and trying to decide, you know, which college am I going to do? Which course am I going to take? You're missing out. Amen. So you might go through the seasons of indecision. You might go through that valley where you're just feeling very indecisive. You know, I'm a person who's very indecisive. I find it, you know, a struggle to take small decisions in my life. Sometimes it can be small things like what job to take or what to buy or what to cook or, you know, simple things like that. Or should I share the gospel to this person or should I just stay silent now? There's always decisions to take. There's always a choice to make. I mean, but don't be stuck in that valley of indecision. You know, there's something that my pastor shared to me when I was in Cochin years back, you know, when I finished my graduation and I had to go for my master's and I didn't know what to do. I didn't know what course, which city, which state, whether to even stay in India or not. And I went to pastor and this pastor quoted the same scripture to me. He said, Molly, there are multitudes in the valley of decision. So just pray and, you know, just take a decision. Just seek God's face, pray about it, sit with the Lord and take a decision. So I asked the Lord like any normal person. I asked the Lord, I asked pastor also, like, what if I take the wrong decision? Even after all the praying and, you know, sitting at the Lord's feet and waiting for weeks and weeks, you know, what if I end up making a wrong step? And he told me something. He told me that even if you happen to go wrong somewhere, because you have sought the Lord, because you have prayed about it, God will somehow lead you back into the straight place. Amen. That's our God. He is a God who will work all things together for our good. Amen. All things together for our good. Amen. But take a decision. Amen. Don't be stuck in that valley, you know, should I do this, should I do that? Should I get baptized, should I not get baptized? Should I marry this guy, should I marry that guy? Amen. Take a decision. Amen. Pray, sit with the Lord, seek his face and take a decision. Amen. If you happen to go wrong by any chance, God will work it together for your good. God will lead you back in the right path. Amen. Hallelujah. The last valley that I want to speak about is from the book of Genesis, chapter 14, verse 10.
Now, the valley of Siddim was full of asphalt pits, and the kings of Sodom and Gomorrah fled. Some fell there, and the remainder fled to the mountains.
Amen. Hallelujah. It's speaking about the valley of Siddim. And if you read in that scripture, it says that the kings of Sodom and Gomorrah, they fled into that valley. So in other words, the valley of Siddim is the valley of sin. Amen. It's a valley that on and off, all of us here have fallen into. Amen. We tend to fall into that valley of sin. But what is important, like I said before, is to come out of it. Amen. Don't stay in the valley of sin. Amen. You know, if you can just get up from that valley, if you can just tell the Lord, Lord, I'm sorry, I confess this before you, I need your help, God can bring you out of it. Amen. Hallelujah. We all fall into this valley. But if you're going to stay there, that's when it destroys you. Amen. It can be a temptation. It can be, I don't know, something that looks more attractive, something worldly, some sort of sin, some wrong book that you read or prayerlessness. you know, don't get stuck in it. Amen. Don't consistently, you know, make it a pattern in your life. Amen. Ask the Lord for help and come out of it. Amen. You know, that's one area that the enemy always tries to bind you in. You know, he tries to just, you know, once you've fallen into a sin, he just tries to, you know, bind you to that sin. He wants you to like just be there forever. You know, he tries to make you think that you cannot come out of it, and then you just feel guilty and condemned and you end up doing the same sin again and again. Amen. But what you need to do is confess it to the Lord and come out of the valley of sin. Amen. It can be something that you're watching, whatever you're reading, your conversations. Amen. Your daily walk with the Lord. I don't know what it is. But if you have fallen somewhere, confess it before the Lord. Amen. We don't have to put a mask before the Lord. We don't have to be a hypocrite before Him. Amen. He knows us inside out. Amen. You know, God so loved us. Amen. God so loved us that He came to save us. Amen. He's a God who wants to bring us out of our valleys. Amen. I don't know what your valley is. Amen. It can be a valley of pain. A valley where you're just feeling so heavy about some things in your life. It can be a valley of sin. Amen. Or it can be a valley of distraction where you've lost your focus from the Lord. Where you're just coming to church just for routine's sake. It can be a valley of dry bones. Where you're feeling so dry, so spiritually so dry, so empty inside. Don't be stuck in it. Amen. The psalmist said, if I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will walk through it. Amen. But God is with you to bring you out. Amen. Hallelujah. It can be a valley of indecisiveness. Where you're not able to take a decision just for a simple thing that, okay, I should go to church every Friday and Sunday. Amen. Today, come out of that valley of indecisiveness. Amen. Hallelujah. God wants to bring us out. Amen. We don't have to stay in that valley. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. This is the word of God. Let's stand up and pray. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. If you have received the word of God in your heart, you can just humble yourself before the Lord and you can just respond to this word in faith. If you can just take that step of faith today to come out of your pain, to come out of your wounds, to come out of your doubt, to come out of whatever is distracting you, to come out of your heaviness. You. He's a God who's promised that if you walk through the fire of the waters also, He will bring you to the place of abundance. He's the God who can wipe away your tears. He's the God who works all things together for our good. He's the God who has plans to prosper us and not to harm us. Come out of your questions. Come out of your reasoning mindsets. Come out of your disappointments, of your offenses. Come out of the things that are lying so dead in your life. Oh, Rabashkari Baba, Rundaraj Raj Radhi Adarathaskir.
Savior, Savior, hear my humble cry.
trust the good shepherd. He's the one who is with you in the valley. He's the one who will never leave you nor forsake you. He's the one who's engraved you in the palm of his hands. He's the one who can give you a second chance, a third chance, a fourth chance, how many ever chances. He's the God who can restore you. He's the God who can heal you. If you can just say this prayer with me right now. Lord Jesus, I thank you for this word. I thank you, O Lord, that you are my good shepherd. That you are with me. That though I walk through the valley, that I will go through it, O Lord. That you will deliver me, O Lord. This evening, Lord, I choose, Lord, to come out of the valley of distraction, of the valley of tears, of the valley of doubt, of the valley of sin, of the valley of indecision, of the valley of heaviness, of the valley of guilt, of every valley of condemnation. I come out right now. In Jesus' name, O Lord. 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 Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father God. Thank you, O Lord Jesus. Thank you, O Lord. You are the restorer, O Lord. You are the deliverer, O Lord.
The shadow of death, your perfect love. Even when I'm caught in the middle of the storms of this life, I want your back. I know you are there. Devil, fear no evil, for my God is with me. My God. come to the stone. Never let go, every high and every low. Never let go, Lord, you never let go. And I will feel no evil. For my God is with me. And if my God is with me, whom then shall I fear?
Whom then shall I fear? Whom then shall I fear?
Whom then shall I fear?
And oh Lord,
you never let go to the calm and to the storm.
That your word stands true, Lord. We thank you, Jesus, Lord, for assuring, Lord, in our heart that you will never leave us nor forsake us, Lord. We thank you for putting us the confidence back, Lord, over your lordship, over your breakthroughs, over your deliverances over our lives, Lord. Even this night, we thank you, Lord. You are a God who takes us through, Lord. Even tonight, whatever your people are going, Lord, this evening, I thank you, Lord, that you are a God who takes your people through the valleys and through the storms and through the indecisions and through the distractions, and will bring them to the other side, Lord, in the blood name of Jesus, Lord. We thank you, Lord. We thank you that you're true to thy word. We cancel every plans of the enemy over tonight, over this meeting, over each and every one, Lord, in the name of Jesus. For we know that the devil is a liar, and he's a liar from the beginning. But we trust the truth of God's word, and the truth of God's word says we are more than conquerors through him who loved us, Lord. And we believe it, we decree it, we receive it now in Jesus' mighty and precious name we pray.
Oh Lord, you never let go.
Look at two people and say, I am a child of God. And let's sit down in the presence of the Lord. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Let's open our Bibles tonight to Psalm chapter 91 and verse 1. Psalm chapter 91 and the first verse.
He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty.
Say of the Lord.
I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress. My God, in him I will trust.
Amen. Tonight I want to title the word, be an umbrella person. Amen. Be an umbrella person. Look to two people and say, be an umbrella person. Hallelujah. This is not an advertisement for any umbrellas. Hallelujah. That you'll remember. Hallelujah. Say, be an umbrella person. Amen. You who dwell under the shadow of the Almighty God, say of him, my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. The word shadow means he who under the umbrella of the presence of God. Hallelujah. He who is under the umbrella of the presence of God. Yeshuvinte kudayada thanalil valarunnavan. Praise the Lord. Avan parayum. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Avinu chelathokke parayanundu. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. The one who is under the Almighty, under the shadow, under the umbrella of God, he has certain things to speak about. Come on, church, tonight. I don't know about you, but I have certain things to speak about. Hallelujah. In 2016. Hallelujah. Because I am chosen to be an umbrella person. He who saved the Lord. Hallelujah. My refuge and my fortress, my God and my trust. For he will rescue me from the snare of the fowler. Amen. Blessed be the name of the Lord. He has certain things to speak forth in confidence. Hallelujah. When you are under the umbrella of his presence, there are things that you can speak forth in confidence. I pray that tonight is the night that God, I feel an anointing of confidence to come upon the church. Hallelujah. I feel that confidence in Jesus Christ and the finished work of the Lord and his victory, hallelujah, of Calvary's cross is once again, hallelujah, being stirred up in the inside of you tonight. I feel that anointing of God over that. Amen. And tonight, I want to speak on the principle of this umbrella. The principle of being under an umbrella. Or you can say, being set under the authority. In other words, you can say the same thing. Be an umbrella person is a person who is set under the authority. Amen. It is a lesson that you can learn in life. It's a priceless lesson. If anyone who has learned this lesson, you will be consistently going up the ladder. You don't stay in the valley for life. You will see yourself going up the ladder. Praise the Lord. You will see yourself being a successful person. You will see yourself being doing things other people has not dared to do. There is a dream that you will dream that other people have not caught it. There are visions that you will capture, but the other people find it difficult to grasp it. There are mysteries that will be revealed where things that are unknown to other people are made known to you. Things will become plain. The mysteries of God's kingdom and the mysteries of God's plan and purpose over your life will become plain over your life. When you are under the principle of being under the authority of God. Amen. Blessed be the name. I've not seen anybody succeeding in life without being under this principle. Anybody who succeeds in life are always people who are under this principle. Amen. You have to recognize this principle over your life and honor this principle all your life. Amen. If you're a young person, you can never succeed, let me tell you, without being under this person. Sometimes I've seen in my life people who even not know that this principle was in God's word, yet honored and seen blessed. Praise God. Hallelujah. Amen. Some of you, I can remember testimonies when you just came to the Lord without knowing one scripture of how to be under authority, but somehow you grasped it in the spirit and obeyed the voice of the Lord, and I've seen your life blessed because you are under this principle. I try my best to fulfill this principle in my life. Amen. Hallelujah. This is a principle that you need to try your best to do it. Look at two people and say, try your best to do it. Hallelujah. You're a principle. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Being set under the authority or being an umbrella person. The Bible is a book that deals with the authority issues. Amen. The first weapon before the devil can destroy us is to take us away from the authority. Example, Lucifer was one of those three most powerful angels in heaven, with Michael the warrior, Gabriel the messenger, and Lucifer was the worship leader. And he said, I will be like him. I will rise above the clouds. I will rise above the Most High God. I will be like the Most High God. When I came seven times, he said, I will make my own congregation in the sights of the north. When I came, the angel became the devil. He stepped outside of the authority of God and he became the devil. As a matter of fact, the Bible says, hallelujah, the number one enemy of authority is self-centeredness. Hallelujah. There was a church split in heaven. Suddenly, he took one third of the angels and left the church of heaven. Or the scene of heaven. Notice the word, I, me. So that greatest enemy of authority is always self-centeredness. Amen. Satan took one third of the angels because of the authority issue. He saw God But he did not want to stay under the authority of God. He came out of that authority and was put out outside heaven. And was cast outside heaven. Amen. Look at Adam and Eve. They were under the authority of God. They were speaking quietly with God, having all the beautiful moments in the Garden of Eden, till the time they stepped out of the authority of God's word and came under a curse. Am I speaking the Bible? The children of Israel was in the brink of closing the most lucrative and the biggest real estate deal in the human history, the promised land. Because they stepped outside of the authority of Moses, they missed it. They allowed 10 people to talk them out. I believe one person can talk you out like Lucifer from the authority or from the principle of authority. 10 people can talk you out of your greatest deals of your life. Find out if you show me the 10 people you hang around with, you message, you text, you speak about, I will tell you, you will end up a victorious life or a defeated life. You can go and check it. Who's the most number of messages? You can know your end will be the end of the person who you hang around with the most. Write it in a book. Even if you don't believe it, just write it. But anyway, it's going to happen. Hallelujah. They did not stay under the authority of Moses. Moses said, let's possess the land at once. But they murmured and they complained and they refused to stay under the authority. And it lost them God's promised land, not for 1 year, but for a generation. Oru thalamura. Hallelujah. Devathinte adhikarathinte adil varanjonde oru thalamura. Hallelujah. Vaagdanam maaripoyi. Stotram. A generation. This is a word of the living God. Some people say, I don't have authority issues. It's not a problem for me. This message will test you. You will be amazed how many people have authority problems, issues. Starting from the beginning, you were born, you have a problem with your father. Anybody who had a bad relationship with father, in my experience, that person will have an authority problem with the husband, with the pastor, with any person in leadership. Any person in leadership. That's why when Ephesians chapter 6, 1 to 8, speaking to believers, it says, honor your parents. Obey your parents. Don't have an authority issue. Respect your parents. You can go home and read it. For it's the first commandment with a blessing. Look at Lot's children who never submitted to authority of parents. What was the end that was happened to them? I'm not telling if your parents said something against God's word to do it. No, don't never do it. I'll come to that. What I'm saying is, on a general note, if you ever doesn't honor and obey the right things God speak through your parents, oh my God, you are under a danger. Look at Lot's children. Hallelujah. Or your work, your boss is the authority. You cannot take your paycheck and speak about him. You cannot, take the paycheck and run him down and, talk about how cheap he is and how bad he is to you and how you did all the work and he got all the credit. Hallelujah. There are times God tests you for a season to be under those kind of people to see how you will respond. Your boss, hallelujah, is planted by God there to see your attitude and how you will respond to God-given, hallelujah, glory to God, seasons of your life. So if somebody is, hallelujah, tormenting you, don't worry. It is God planted there to see how you are going to, as a Christian, as one who follows Jesus, respond. The moment you consistently respond in the right way, the torment will get over. Hallelujah. Amen. So don't treat him like the one, he's supposed to clean the shoes and you are supposed to be the boss. Amen. You have to honor him, respect him, however jerk he is. You know what I'm saying? And to bless his life. Otherwise, pastor, is there any other way? Yes, get out of that company. And get into a company where you can submit to. Because the Bible says in Ephesians 6, whatever you do, do it as you're doing it for the Lord. God says, I see what you do. And he puts certain jobs right there to see how you would submit, hallelujah, to certain authority, even when they treat you badly. Ah, come on, church, tonight. God says how you will respond to certain authority figures, even when they treat you badly. You know, as the talk goes on, I will speak to you about not only parents' work, but the Romans 13 speaks about honor your government, respect your government, obey your government. Hebrews 13, 17 speaks about honor the servants of God, the leaders who God has put over you as overseas, who takes care of your soul. Speaks about godly control. Ephesians 5 speaks about submit to your husbands. So I'll come to all that. But let's see what the word authority comes from. The word authority comes from the word author. Author. God is the author of all authority. He is the authority. Amen. God is the author of all authority. Where does this authority come from? He is the one who started it. If you have a complaint, don't complain to me. Go complain to God. Amen. He's the author. He started that principle. It goes still there. So he is the author of all authority. He's the should. So in that sense, he should be the authority at home. He should be authority in marriage. He should be authority in work. He should be authority in family. Just imagine if he's an authority over the nation. How many of you are working towards and believing towards that God, hallelujah, one of these days will be the authority over the nation of India, praise the Lord, the city of Bangalore. How many of you believe that and pray for that? Why we submit to authority? Romans chapter 13, verses 1 and 2. Romans chapter 13, why we should submit to authority? It's a powerful point. If you get this point in your spirit, you will never go anything against authority.
Let every soul be subjected to the governing authorities. For there is no authority except from God, and the authorities that exist are appointed by God. Therefore, whoever resists the authority resists the ordinance of God. And those who resist will bring judgment on themselves.
Amen. Those who resist the authority resist the ordinances of God and brings the judgment upon themselves. It's not my word. It's Paul by the Spirit written in Romans chapter 13 and verses 1 and 2. Any authority that you try to resist, which God has put you under, you are bringing a judgment upon the consequences you will have to face. So it's a time that 2016 in the beginning, I, me will go. And we won't rebel against any authority. Because the more you rebel like, against authority, you are looking more like the devil. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Because that's why the reason God cast him out of the heaven. What happens when we submit to the authority? What happens when we submit to the authority? Number one, I come to that umbrella thing. It's an umbrella. It's a covering. Praise God. What happens? It's a covering. It's an umbrella. Amen. Blessed be the name of the Lord. It's a protection. It's a covering. It's an authority, like an umbrella over your life. Amen. Are you with me? Overseer. The word overseer or pastor comes from the word oversee. It's also an umbrella, oversee. Under. Amen. Hallelujah. Over you. Like an umbrella over you. Hallelujah. So we have to get under what God has put over us. Amen. Hallelujah. Write it down. We have to get under what God has put over us so that we can get over what God wants to put under us. Oh, did you get that? If we have to get under what God, we have to get under what God has put over us so that we can get over what God has put under us. If you want to rule, you have to be under a rulership. If you want to be doing great things where God wants to trust you, you have to come under before God can put you over. We have to get under what God has put over us so that we can get over what God has put under us. You with me? So until you get under what God wants to put over you, can't trust you to put over what He wants to put under you. You with me? It's as simple as that. I know some of you don't like it, but I don't care. If you don't care, you are picturizing next to the devil. It's not an easy thing. God watches how you respond to the authority of God. And only accordingly, He will put things under you. Hallelujah. When you will understand how God works, I can give you scripture after scripture from Bible. That is the principle God instituted. It is the author. He is the author that you and I will understand. He is the author of all authority. Amen. Are you with me, church? So anyone wants to have things under you, honor what God has put over you. Amen. Number two, it is a covering. It is also a place of protection. How many of you have seen, if you're a person who is walking and hails and storms and rain, is thunder and lightning and hailstorms are coming, and if somebody does it like this, what do you say? You say, he's crazy. You know what I'm saying? That's what some of us are doing. We are tormented with problems and defeats and harassed with all sort of things. And what are we doing? Hallelujah. See, it's a protection. It's like taking away umbrella. Some of us, it'd be crazy. That's what exactly. You know, I remember Mike Murdock, I think the man of God, said, the uncommon protege takes protection under the uncommon mentor when an uncommon danger hits him. When I see an uncommon danger, you know what I do? I go under my uncommon mentor and I stay under it. You won't understand. Years back, I took 2.5 years, I was under my pastor. So many people said, oh, you left the church. So many people, the pastor is not going to do anything more. That's a small, you know, little kutty hall that he's finished and he's left the church and went. And so many people had some hurt feelings and all that. But what I've never told people is that was the time there were so many attacks that was spoken against me. And because I was under an uncommon mentor at that time, none of those accusations, none of those problems that came against me even touched me. By the time I came, I was equipped. I was strong. I knew how to handle certain issues. You heard me? So when there are problems, when there are hailstorms, know that you have to come under the authority of God's word, the authority of the headship of Christ, and the authority in our lives where God has instituted over us, put over us. And then you will see these storms, these hailstorms cannot touch your life. Amen. Hallelujah. It is like walking out of hell's hammer against your life. When you're belted by problems and you are putting that umbrella. If you don't put that umbrella, you will be drenched with defeats, drenched with pestilence, drenched with negativity, drenched with things that you don't understand. Hallelujah. Amen. Are you with me, church? That's why when you rebel against parents or authority figures or pastor or talk about people in leadership God has put over your life, badmouth them, You have to be careful. You remove authority. You are stepping out of the authority of God. And you are no longer under the protection plan of God. How many of you want to be under the protection plan of God? Uh-huh. Praise God. Number three. What happens when you submit to authority? A positioning will come. When you get under the authority, you are getting into the zone of blessing. Look at two people and say, zone of blessing. You are in a blessing chain. Amen. It just flows from one person to another person, another person. He has commanded blessing and life forevermore in that chain. Hallelujah. And you are a part of that chain game. Suddenly you are in alignment for the blessing of God, the provisions of God, all that God has for you. Hallelujah. Come under that blessing plan. Amen. And when you are out of that alignment and you are on your own, you are getting outside of the real blessing that God has for your life. Come on, church. Let's do it together as a church. Let's be under the authority of God's word. In everything God said, and let's see 2016 what will hold for us. Because there is something about the authority of home, authority of the husband, the authority of the family, the authority of the church, the authority of a pastor. There is something God has over it. Amen. Hallelujah. Number four, when you are under the authority of God, what happens when you submit to the authority of God? It's a place of perfection. God puts authority over you to bring the best in you. Amen. Some people are not willing, you know. An athlete, he needs a coach. Why? If he tries to do things by himself, he will break his leg. He will break his spine. He will break his hands. Some of you are in a broken condition and you are praying and fasting and the mind games are going on. Let me tell you a simple thing. You moved out of the authority of God. You're not able to pray. You're not able to, you know, seek God. You are feeling bad about everyone. You are feeling hurt. You feel that you are cheated. All those things. You know why? Because somewhere along the line, you moved out of the alignment of God. There is a hidden battle going on in your spirit. Because God has put the coach over your life. Amen. I said there are three ways to learn in life. One is the easy way. One is the difficult way. And the next one is the tragic way. The easy way is when you learn from your own mentor's mistake. The difficult way is when you learn from your mistakes. The number third way is you neither learn from your mistake or from the mentor's mistake. It's called the tragic way. Look at it in an easy way, not a difficult way, or a tragic way. Three types of ways. Amen. Which way do you want to learn? I would like to learn the easy way. I don't want to make the mistakes my pastor made. I don't want you to make the mistakes that I made. Next is a difficult way. To make the mistakes, you put your hand on fire and learn it. Next is the tragedy. Neither you learn from your mistake or my mistake. Praise the Lord. It's a big mistake. You are a big mistake. Are you with me? Put it somewhere. Sometimes your mentor is your tormentor. Praise God. Amen. If you want to bring the best in your life, your mentor has to be your tormentor. He is not put there to, you know, to be, say, oh, cutie pie. Oh, so lovely. No, that's not this. He pushes you to your future. He's not comfortable for where you are. He's not going to appreciate and applaud you for every time, you know, you do this. He puts your collar down. He puts you down so that he can lift you up into the next level. He's the one who does not point to your one, how wonderful you are. He put pressure on you just like a diamond is pressured to bring forth a beautiful diamond out of it. Amen. Like a diamond in the rough. You know, immense pressure to become a diamond. Are you with me? So to bring the best in you, whether it is your parents, whether it is your pastor, they will be your tormentors. Amen. Praise God. Don't call me Pastor Tormentor. Some of you. Praise God. Certain people, they say, it doesn't matter what authority figure says. I'm not going to listen. Let me tell you, there are 2-3 words, you know, I corrected some people. People are using these days. One is, oh, they are forcing me. They are controlling me. Let me tell you, God wants pastors to force you, to put pressure on you, to move into your promised land. They are controlling. Hebrews 13:17 says, they are supposed to control you. That is called godly control. When they abuse you, when they ask you to buy you drinks and once they ask you to, you know, do crazy things of the world, then they are abusing their control. There are pastors who say, oh, to sleep with me, and there are pastors who say, oh, to drink with me. I mean, these are people who are abusing you, their control, their power. But there are pastors who are trying to get you to the next level, feeding you with the word of God. Every Friday, every Sunday, spending time with you, loving you, taking care of you, taking risk for you, praying for you, interceding for you, fasting for you, tearing for you. Oh, they are God's people. You better respect them and honor them. Never put down somebody who God has put, hallelujah, on the center of his plan. Never break the heart of a servant of God. Because sometimes, never break the heart of your parent for doing something that they've told you not to do it and you end up doing it. Sometimes they say, oh, I'm not going to do that. All these things are stupid in this generation. Yeah. They don't know what they're talking about. I don't want to respect. Now, I know some people, you tell them something, they do the opposite in front of you. I say, in other words, it's trying to communicate, hey, I don't care a D of what you say. The D comes from the D. The deacon D. The devil. Amen. So what is my script if I'm going to have that attitude? Let me tell you, you are going to be drenched with defeats over your life. That's your script. You're going to be hammered by hell. You don't believe it? Consequences, when you face it, you will believe it. Sin has consequences. When you go outside of the word of God, there are consequences. I'm not going to be one of those preachers who says, oh, everything is going to be all right. God will forgive you. There are no consequences. That's not the word of God. You showed me any part of scripture. The Bible says sin has consequences. God will forgive you when you confess it before him and say, Lord, I'm sorry, I want to come out of it. He brings you out in superpower. Are you with me, church? Blessed be the name of the Lord. Are you with me? Look at some of the examples. I'm telling you this tonight to reach your highest potential. Amen? Amen. I tried to preach another message my best, but Holy Spirit was, you know, saying, look at it. Mordecai became Esther's authority. She had to come under what God had over her so that she can be over what God had put under her. Amen. Before Esther became a queen and ruled the nation, she has to come under who God put over her so she can be over what God put under her. Elijah was Elisha. Elisha was a covering. Elijah was a covering to Elisha. Ruth and Naomi. He says, where you go, I go. Where you stay, I stay. Your people. In other words, she said, understood the authority and said, I am not going to leave my covering for anything. Matthew chapter 8 and the verse 9, the centurion says, he said, I am a man set under the authority. I have soldiers under me. I am a man set under authority, so I have soldiers under me. In other words, he was saying, there is somebody who is over me. And because I am under that person who is over me, I can be over to those people who are under me effectively. Come on, are you understanding this tonight? And Jesus marveled and said, oh man, what a man of faith. Is Jesus looking and marveling at you? All the churches become quiet. I like one preacher said, he said, but you know, it's a good thing to be quiet. That means it's going in. So it's not taking and picking and choosing what you want to. You know, there are some people who pick and choose the scriptures they like, the scriptures they want to confess, the messages they like. Other messages they don't put much pressure on to their ears. They'll be distracted, like you said, the valley of distraction. You know what happened to Achan, you know what I'm saying? Don't pick and choose God's word. Amen? Don't say, oh, is it okay to sleep with a girl before I get married to her? No, you can't do that. Is it okay to sleep with her? Not at all. After marriage, you can sleep anytime, anywhere. Can I walk half naked? No, Bible says no. Lord asked me a question. He said, you know, somebody asked me, you know, what's wrong with that? Lord asked me to question. He said, will that person walk in that way in heaven? I pictured. I don't think so, Lord. When all your people are in garments, you know, of righteousness and white garments and one, I don't think one person. So you can pick and choose what you want to do and what you want to. You can't. You either obey God's word or you don't obey God's word. You are either under the authority of God, you are not under the authority of God. You are either in heaven or you are not in heaven. You either obey God or you are not obeying God. You are under the authority of, submit to the authority of God, or you neither are under the authority of God. You can't be in between. Amen. You can pick and choose what you are going to do. Glory to God. Are you with me? Love your neighbor as yourself. You have to love him as yourself. You can't pick and choose. Bible says, he who hates his brother is worse. Is what he says? He's claiming to be light, but in darkness. Doesn't matter what people throw at you, try to hurt you, you have to still choose to forgive and love if you are a true Christian. 1 John 2:9 says, otherwise you claim to be in light, but you are in darkness. So you can't pick and choose what you want. Are you with me? Look at two people and say, I'm an umbrella fella. Not a jolly good fellow, but an umbrella fella. Amen. Praise God. So how to get under the authority of God? Number one, very easy, know your Bible. The very easiest way of being under the authority of God is what Bible says. Not what the Supreme Court says, not what the TV evangelist says, not what one prophet says, know what but God's word says. Bible says, he who delights in the law of the Lord, he will prosper. Amen. Are you with me, church? Hallelujah. But some people say, oh no, I choose to not to do it. Ooh la la. Praise the Lord. You're going to dance to that tune. Are you with me? Marriage is an umbrella. Somebody says, why should I get married and stay to the marriage covenant? Because marriage is an umbrella. Head of every man is Christ. Are you with me? You have to know your Bible, even when it comes to marriage. How many of you ever taken time to see what a godly marriage is all about? How many of you at least gone through what marriage is after your wedding day? I have gone through many times. Marriage is an umbrella. Head of every man is Christ. So any young girls who are going to get married, let me tell you one secret. Find an umbrella guy. Any young girls? Find a umbrella guy. Not one who has a umbrella. Umbrella guy. Somebody who submitted. You will have peace, provision, protection. Even when you are lonely, you know what I'm saying? You will have that person to count on. Hallelujah. Number two. How to set under yourself under the authority. Humility. Everybody say humility. First one is what? Know your Bible. Second one is humility. Humility. Humble yourself under the mighty hand of God. You know, just imagine, you know, in the context, to make you understand, just imagine, you know, I am the supposed to be the umbrella and Dipti is supposed to be the one who is under me. Just imagine if Dipti is holding the umbrella and I'm walking with her. I'll be struggling because she's 5'6" and I'm 5'8½". You know what I'm saying? I'm the taller fellow. And if I hold it like that, she can walk without any struggle. If she's holding, I will have to walk like this. In other words, you have to be always under the person who is taller than you. Oh, come on, church, tonight. You have to be always be under the one who is taller than you. Your parents, they're taller than you. Your pastor, they're taller than you. Your husband, they're taller than you. They're supposed to be taller than you. Humility. Psalm 133 says, anointing always flows down. It flows down. It flows where humility is. It is anointing that flows down from the hem, from the garments of Aaron. It flows. Anointing always flows in humility, flows down. How many of you know water always flows down? You know what I'm saying? Holy Spirit is a pitcher of water. It always flows down. And if you have a husband who is under the authority of God, you better get yourself right now under the authority. If you don't have one, pray. You be the one who is under the authority of God's word. God will manipulate him to come under the authority of God. Don't be under the authority of your brother, sister, brother-in-law, sister-in-law. Be under the authority of God's opinion, not their opinion. Amen. Hallelujah. There's only one authority. If your house has two authorities, just imagine two heads in one body. You look like a freak. Some people says, no head, you are dead. Without the head, you are dead. Without the authority, you are dead. The conclusion, I want to ask you this. What are we doing? Are we turning our umbrella? Are we closed umbrella or are we turning an umbrella into a sword? Are we fighting? Have we closed our umbrella and are we fighting against authority figures? Over things, over people? Instead of being under the authority and submitted to them? Are we forgiving one another? Submitted to each other? What are we doing? You have an answer to all your problems. Hallelujah. Somebody says, my rights, my rights, my rights. You say, my rights. You sound like Lucifer. I want it like this. I want it like that. Is that what we are doing? I, me. I want the meeting to get over at 9:45. I want it. Praise God. It makes God sick. Only time that makes God sick, you know why? When God's people said, I, my, me. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Number three. Now what are you doing? What are you doing tonight? Some of you have loveless moments of your life. How many of you have loveless? If you are a husband or a wife, you should listen to this. Loveless moments. There are hot love. Hot love is your honeymoon period. Full kissing. In marriage, I'm speaking about, okay? Some people, hot love is outside the covenant of marriage. That kissing will, you're kissing the devil's lips. Then there is the another love called the warm love. That is, you still love each other, but it's little warm because the bills have started coming. The rent has to be paid. The debt has come out of nowhere. Love is there. Lot of dishes to wash, but raising up the children, it has become a little warm. And number three, it is called the cold love. That is the most important stage where you don't have no feelings towards each other. The sex is not going to drive you anymore. Feelings are not moving your heart anymore. But that's the most important time of your life. If you could say, irrespective of what I feel, it doesn't matter. Because of the covenant of marriage, I still choose to be faithful. I choose to love my partner. Still choose to be with them. Still choose to honor the covenant of marriage. And if you are able to say that under that circumstance, God will restore all the other two loves back to you. Are you with me? It's the time, it's a season to come under the umbrella again. Because of the covenant. What are we doing tonight? Some people, that's the time they get into affairs. They think beyond the marriage. And who people, usually people who get into marital affairs, the people who convince themselves they'll never get, they're so self-righteous, they say, I will never get into a problem. You know who get into an affair? Who cultivate a relationship with a third party. Talking and texting messages. Who get into an affair? Compare your spouse with somebody else. Who get into an affair? You connect the wrong person. Connect sensual thoughts. You start imagining sensually with another person. You get into wrong issues. You think, oh, sin has kicks, but it has got kickbacks. David had an affair. She became pregnant and she SMS'd David. I went to a medical shop. It's showing the wrong color. So David, emergency plan, SMS back. Don't worry, I have my no Victoria's Secrets in place. Uriah comes sleep with your wife. He made him drunk. But Uriah, while he was most drunk, he was sober than the most drunk person. He said, I will never sleep when my other people are fighting against a war. I will never sleep with my girl. So he was a man there, and now David is, he was a man of integrity, a man of integrity, and here is David in the problem. Are you with me, church, tonight? What are we doing tonight? Affair brings bondage. It's not freedom, it brings bondage. It is private, but one day it will become public. So never think about it. But David, when he came to his senses, he said, to you and to you alone I've sinned, Lord. I'm sorry, Lord. When Nathan came and rebuked him, he came under the authority of God's word again and said, to you and to you I've sinned, Lord. Take, Lord, this mess away from me, Lord. What are we doing tonight? Are we saying, Lord, to you and to you I've sinned, Lord. I want to come under your umbrella again. I want to be an umbrella person. I want to be under what God put over me so that I can be over what God has put under me. I want to be an umbrella person. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Let's close our eyes in prayer. Let's close our eyes in prayer tonight. Tonight, ask the Lord to that every thought against the authority figures be broken in the name of Jesus over your life tonight. Whether it is your father, whether it is a deep hurt, deep-rooted hurt that has come from the father, and you're still struggling. with an authority figure, whether it's your husband, your pastor, or your teacher. But you can't learn from anyone else. You are trying to learn, but you're a self-taught person. Most self-taught people have a problem with authority, because you will not reach up to your potential. You will miss out on the plan of God, on the protection program of God, on the provision program of God. You should personalize this word and say, Lord, I want to be an umbrella guy, because Bible says he who dwells under the umbrella of Almighty God, he can confidently say, he is my Lord, he is my fortress, he is the God whom I trust, for he will rescue me from the snare of the fowler. Thousands fall at my side, 10,000 at my right side. Near me it shall not come. We give you praise. We give you glory. We give you honor, Lord. We thank you, Jesus. Let me tell you, it is not to throw stones at you. I love people. I love everybody. It is not to throw a particular stone at you, but I'm just telling you the truth of God's word. I'm just telling you the principle of God's word. Don't even allow the devil to think, oh, pastor is targeting me. No, I love you. I will love you with God's love. I'm telling you tonight this so that you will be blessed. Your generation shall be blessed. Your family shall be blessed. Your ministry shall be blessed. Your finances shall be blessed. We give you praise. We give you glory, Lord. We give you honor. Rama Ravashika. Get under what God has put over you, so God can put you over what God He wants to put under you tonight. Say, Lord, I come under, Lord, what you have put. I want to come under, Lord, to people who you have put over me, Lord. And I want to be over who you have put under me, that your kingdom shall be established. Your kingdom, the chain game, the game plan of God will work. The bigger picture will prevail. This can be one of the most important things that you can learn in your spiritual life. If you grasp it in your spirit by faith, you will see, I sense a hidden plan of God going to be revealed over your life. Something that was hidden over your life are going to be unleashed over your life tonight. In the name of Jesus, I confess it. I decree it over your life. I sense the Spirit of God telling me that. Oh, we give you praise and we give you glory. Thank you, Jesus. I thank you, Jesus. I thank you, Jesus. Can we say a prayer tonight together? In the comfortable position as you are in, it says, Lord Jesus, I ask you tonight to forgive me anytime I have spoken against you. I've spoken against your word. I've spoken against your authority. Or I've spoken against the authority figures you put over my life. I ask you forgiveness tonight, Lord. I ask you to cleanse me with your precious blood. And I ask you to change my attitude, Lord. And I ask you to break every curse over my life, Lord. And I ask you, Lord, tonight to release me into your protection plan, provision plan, and I can be over who you have put under me, Lord. I ask you, Father, in Jesus' name, I renounce the devil, I renounce the flesh, I renounce self-centeredness, I renounce pride, I renounce the flesh, I renounce all thoughts and negativity that is against authority right now. In the name of Jesus, let those thoughts be broken out of my life forever. Heal me, Lord. In Jesus' name, I ask you, Lord. I believe you have healed me. You've set me free. I receive this word by faith over my life. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Now anoint me afresh to be united to your plan, Lord, and to your purpose. In Jesus' name, amen, amen, amen. Would we all stand up in the presence of the Lord tonight? If you've really prayed from your heart tonight, if you've really surrendered your heart tonight, if you really made that prayer, I feel a new awakening, something that you have never experienced. A new season will come over your life tonight. Hallelujah. A new season. New season. New season. New season. You will feel the confidence that you're not alone anymore. This is the teaching that is taught in the greatest of churches that God is using around the world. This is one teaching that has been spoken. When you honor the authority, you honor God. When you rebel against authority, you are against God, the ordinances of God, the consequences and judgments that you are bringing onto yourself. But tonight, if you come under the mercy of God, there is a freedom and the liberty that you will feel across your heart. And in your life, you will feel a weight that has been lost. You will sense a release, a supernatural breakthroughs in your spirit. You will sense the best of God. You will sense a fresh anointing of God taking over your life. Hallelujah. Would you sing the song? Mercy is falling. It's falling. Hallelujah. We give you praise. We give you glory. We give you honor tonight.
Mercy is falling, is falling, is falling. Mercy is falls like a sweet spring rain. Mercy is falling all over me. Mercy is falling, is falling. Mercy is falls like a sweet spring rain. Mercy is falling all over me. I receive your mercy. Hey, oh, I receive your grace. Hey, oh, I will dance forevermore. Hey, oh, I receive your mercy. Hey, oh, I receive your grace. Mercy is falling, is falling, is falling. Mercy is falling like a sweet spring rain. Mercy is falling all over me. Mercy is falling, is falling, is falling. Mercy falls like a sweet spring rain. Mercy is falling all over me. Hey, oh, I receive your mercy. Hey, oh, I receive your grace. Hey, oh, I will dance forevermore. Hey, oh, I receive your mercy. Hey, oh, I receive your grace. Hey, oh, I will dance forevermore. Hey, oh, I receive your mercy. Hey, oh, I receive your grace. Hey, oh, I will dance forevermore. Hey, oh, I receive your mercy. Hey, oh, I receive your grace. Hey, oh, I will dance forevermore. Mercy is falling, is falling, is falling. Mercy is falling like a sweet spring rain. Mercy is falling all over me. Mercy is falling, is falling, is falling. Mercy is falling like a sweet spring rain. Mercy is falling all over me. Forevermore. Hey, receive your mercy. Hey, oh, I receive your faith. Hey, oh, I'll dance forevermore. Hey, oh, I receive your mercy. Hey, oh, I receive your faith. Hey, oh, I'll dance forevermore. Hey, oh, I receive your mercy. Hey, oh, I receive your grace. Hey, oh, I'll dance forevermore.
Receive this message tonight by faith. Put your hands together and give a clap offering to Jesus tonight. Let the river of God flow from the inside tonight. Hallelujah. Let every tiredness, the supernatural favor over your life tonight. Lord, we give you praise. Thank you, Jesus. We thank you, Lord. We thank you, Jesus, Father. We give you praise. We give you glory. I sense somebody, hallelujah, having problem in your body tonight. God is healing you. God is healing you. Put your hands on that place and receive your healing tonight in the name of Jesus. Whatever, I sense a tremendous breakthrough in your hallelujah body right now. Oh, we give you praise. Confirm thy word, Lord, tonight. Oh yes, confirm thy word tonight, Lord, with signs, miracles and wonders following. I pray this word shall not return back void, shall accomplish the purpose it has been sent, a 30, a 60, a 100 fold, Lord. I bring everybody under that umbrella of authority of God's word, Lord, under the umbrella of the shadow of the Almighty God, under the umbrella of your presence, under the umbrella of everything, God, you have put them under, your Lord. I bring them, Lord, right now, by the power of thy word, by the power of the authority that is vested in me. I bring them under the plan of God, the protection plan, the provision plan, the enlargement plan of God, right now, in the name of Jesus, Lord. I thank you having done it, Lord. I thank you for your faithfulness. I thank you for the word in season. I thank you, Lord, that you are faithful to do it. In Jesus' mighty and precious name, as I bless your people in the name of the Father, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, in the name of the Holy Spirit, let this bring everlasting healing and redemptive powers over their lives, Lord. In the name of Jesus, Lord. You said you will build your church and the gates of hate shall not prevail against them, Katavi. I pray head to toe, let them be completely liberated to walk in the plan and the greatness of your plan and the enlargement of your plan. Hallelujah. Enlarge their steps, their foot will not slip again. In the name of Jesus, Lord. Let this word, hallelujah, be a hallelujah. Yes, an armor in their sight, Lord, all the days of their life. That's right. In Jesus' mighty and precious name we pray. And the church said, oh, come on, church, give a shout of praise once again. A shout of triumph, a shout of praise. Come on. We give you glory, Lord. We give you honor. We thank you. We thank you. We thank you. We thank you, Jesus. Amen. Go in the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ. May God be with you. Jesus Christ is Lord. Hallelujah. Go in the victory of our Lord. Amen. God bless you. Amen. Look at somebody and said, go in peace. Amen. Good. God bless you. Amen.